because there's great stories behind them all. And the concept of this program, today's program, it's a portrait concert of Garth's works with a variety of performers. And the center point of it is to basically show off the viola and how it works with other instruments. And the program is with a view to an album of these works being recorded down the road. In terms of the timing of this concert, a lot of the texts and contexts feature women. So of course, yesterday being Nolly Maman, it's a very nice timing for this program. So the first work is Still Points, Harmonic Fantasy on a Theme by Talis. And this was composed in 2022, so very recently. And charmingly, it was composed, commissioned by students of Jean Soulem, and they funded it themselves and chose Garth to compose it. So Garth, you chose Thomas Tallis's third mode melody, which Vaughan Williams made famous, and as the inspiration for this work. Can you tell us how you use this 16th century theme by Tallis in this
version? Yes. Good morning, everybody. This theme by Tallis, I've always liked it very much. It's a great tune, but then a tune is not a piece, is it? You have to decide, how can I put this tune into a piece? And I had the idea from illuminated manuscripts, like the Book of Kells, for example, where you put a text and you bring light on it by illustrating it with things like animals or trees or drawings. And in music, I wanted to do it in all directions. So I wanted to illuminate the theme from behind by writing some medieval music, which is older than this theme. This is this 16th century theme. And then I wanted to illustrate it from in front with some more contemporary music, shining the other way. And I was like to illustrate it from beneath by adding a second voice underneath. And finally, this is my main interest, was illustrating from above by putting in lots of very high harmonics which shine down light on the tune of Thomas Tallis, and you see it in a new light, I hope.
Fantastic. And Ruth, you perform in a very broad range of ensembles, from orchestras to solo and everything like that. So can you just tell us a little bit about what might make a difference to you in your approach to both learning and performing when you're actually performing with the composer?
Yeah, well, I guess you get the intimacy of trying lots of ideas and real nuance that actually the composer can really lean into and tell you if you're going in the right direction. A lot of the time as a performer of classical music, you're performing music that, unfortunately, the composer's dead, so you can never know if the direction of your instinct is really in line with that they wanted. And yet at the same time, every piece played by someone is going to be different because they bring their personal approach. So by playing with a composer, you can really play with a lot more subtlety, a conversation, and it kind of develops over time, much like a friendship. You know, there's more nuance and there's more colour that comes to it as time goes on.
And actually, Ruth, you just hit on something that I know lots of composers really love, when they get multiple performances of their works by different performers, because every performer, as you say, brings something new to the composer's work. And Garth, why did you choose Still Points?
Well, the title, Still Points, is because in the piece there are four still points where nothing happens, a little silence, like that. And these moments are very nice. In French, you say it's when an angel walks past. So little angel goes past in the piece four times. And they're very relaxed silence, it's not tense at all. We just stop, we're all here together. Very nice. And of course, the title, Still Points, of course, comes from T.S. Eliot in the Four Quartets, where he says, the still point in a turning world, at the still point, there the dance is. So I was trying to make this very still dance in Still Points. That's the explanation.
Okay. And just a quick final question for you, Ruth, because this is for two violas, this work. And often ensemble work is for contrasting instruments. Hmm. And so do you often play for two violas or pieces?
It's not that rarely programmed. Probably one of the more popular works is a piece actually by George Benjamin called Viola, Viola. And it's very interesting in that there are some similarities, but mainly it's almost a fight, I would say, Viola, Viola. Whereas in this one, it's much more complementary because we're kind of playing with textures and light and nuance, and we're kind of leaning into each other a lot back and forth, so it's much more egalitarian, and it's much more nuance and subtlety than maybe what you would expect.
Probably describing Garth Knox there. I'll hand over to the two of them. Thank you very much. 2019, so an earlier piece than the last one. And it was commissioned by the Walter Whitton Foundation for the Hindemith competition. It was premiered by and is also dedicated to violist Gunter Tufel. For the purposes of today's concert, Sinead and Garth are going to perform part one first, and then we're going to have Zoë Conway with the wonderful wind songs, after which this album is named, or will be named. And then Sinead and Garth will come back and play parts two and three. So we're breaking up the pocket concerto today for the performance. I will only speak to them once about it, I won't speak to them twice about it. So if Garth and Sinead are ready, would you welcome them to the stage? Standard concerto model of three movements. It's not for viola soloist and full orchestra, as we see here today, but rather for viola and cello. Can you tell us why you called it a concerto?
Well, I wanted to write a concerto, but I wanted to be realistic and modest in my ambitions. And so I decided for many reasons to replace the orchestra, the entire orchestra, with one solo cello. Mainly for economic reasons, it's much cheaper to buy more. But also for social reasons, for balance problems actually. Normally a viola is not really made to dominate over a big symphony orchestra. It has a very nice middle and low register. And if you play in front of a big orchestra, you're tempted to always play the high stuff and play very brilliant on the top. But the viola's viola has this very nice middle and bottom range. And I thought I could explore this better with a cello, which is like a big brother to us, with the same strings, but just much bigger. And cello is a great instrument. You can do many things. You can replace an orchestra quite easily, can't you?
Of course.
Idea. So economic reasons and musical reasons as well.
Fantastic. And Sinead, you're the cellist in the Marmon Quartet, which I'm going to boast, because you can't, but they won the prestigious Banff International String Quartet competition, and which is the top prize for quartets. And this past October, just 2023, Garth did a tour of Ireland with the Marmon Quartet, and they premiered a new work by Garth called Secret Letters, composed specially for them. And that was with the National String Quartet Foundation. Now, this is totally different experience for you because you're not in your own quartet. You're now performing as a duo and also with Garth beside you playing, not on the stage. Can you just tell us that's so close?
Sure. I mean, it was so nice for me to spend a week with Garth. During the quartet tour, really getting to know each other. We managed to have a look at the pocket concerto then also. And yeah, I've been a great fan of his works. And it was such a pleasure to premiere his quartet. And it was a very personal work. Garth got us to write him secret letters, hence the name. And he asked us very probing questions about the ins and out of our own quartet and our favourite memories and our lowest point in quartet life. So I think he really got an insight into each of us personally as well. So it's been great also getting an insight into Garth as a person as well as a fantastic composer and musician. So yeah, it's great.
Yeah, we're delighted to have you as a duo. Now to get back to the work with Garth, you know, we mentioned three movements earlier, and they're very, very different movements. Can you just give us a little insight?
I'd say very briefly, for me, the classical concerto with the three movements, the first one is usually very serious and usually quite heroic. The second one is usually very slow and beautiful. And the third one is fun. So I tried to reproduce that schema here. The first one that you hear now is a homage to Hindemith, who is a composer from the early 20th century who wrote a lot for viola, did a lot for viola. He's based on heavy German style, so I've tried to capture this in music also, but then I've added a bit of my own.
Yeah.
So homage to you.
And then the second movement, the third movement.
And then
Sinead, can you just give us a little insight? There's a cadenza at the end, an improvised cadenza, and how you approach that.
Yes, well, in the third movement, which we'll play in a little while, Garth very kindly invited me to put my own compositional technique to work, which don't have much experience in it, but I wrote a little Irish cadenza. The third movement is called Irish Variations. Yes. And so I thought I'd put a bit of trad in there as well and have a little bit of fun.
So that's perfect. When they come back on stage, they'll probably talk a little more about what's to can lead the way now with part of it.
Thank you.
Thank you.
so in between the two, and I guess throughout COVID. The commission was made possible by Arts Council England and the Nicholas Boas Charitable Trust. And each of these three songs features a different kind of wind. And they were written for and dedicated to Catherine Clark as part of her singing viola project. The words of the third song, Fairy Wind, Three Windy Haiku, which were composed, written by Irish poet Gabriel Rosenstock. He wrote them in both English and Irish, and I'm very happy to say that Zoë will be singing them in Irish today. So can you welcome to the stage, please, Garth Knox and Zoë Conway to perform. Can you just give us a little bit of sense of the different texts?
Sure. Briefly, the first text, the 9th century text, found in an illuminated manuscript, which we were talking about earlier, written by a monk who was obviously probably on Iona copying out some manuscript, got bored. He wrote a little poem, which is very beautiful, all about how the wind is wild tonight, it tosses the sea's white hair. And he says, I have no fear, it is the calm waters that bring the sharp men from the north. So he was worried about the Vikings, for him bad weather was really good news. But I like to speak this contrast. In the first song, that's you know, the wild wind being very, very something very beneficial is the idea of it. The second one is a traditional song, which probably many of you know, the month of January, very sad story about, well, you'll hear the words as they go through. Well, it's one of these typical songs where a girl gets pregnant, her parents disown her. It's the typical everyday story, and she's very sad. But the wind, she feels everyone's against her, father's against her, boyfriend's against her, and even the wind is making her feel bitterly, bitterly cold. So that's the thing. And the last one, as we said, is these wonderful wind haikus written by Gabriel Rosenstock, for whom I'm very grateful, and which we made up just like that in 2 days. I asked him, do you have a specific poem about wind? And he hesitated a bit, and 2 days later, sent me three, he'd just written three haikus. So, yeah. And I'm very happy that Zoe's been doing the Irish thing. They're bilingual haikus. So it's a great performance, Zoe, I would say, as well. She's doing the songs beautifully.
So now, Zoe, you need no introduction, at home or abroad. And as a fiddler, singer, and composer indeed yourself, largely of traditional music, but can you just tell us a little bit about this contemporary music collaboration?
Well, it's very exciting to get to work with Gareth, and of course, it's very unusual for me to have no fiddle. So it's a pleasure to get to sing and to work with the words and with the kind of breath in the song, you know, about the wind and the kind of techniques that Gareth uses in the tunes. And I've really enjoyed as well listening to the kind of duet ideas, you know, the viola in different kind of settings. So it's a pleasure to get to hear as a composer what Gareth is doing.
Brilliant. And Gareth, you were born in the Rotunda, literally across the road here, and your father was the minister in the church here a few doors down, so you're a dub. And you grew up in Scotland, so obviously traditional music is, you're no stranger to that either, you know. And so can you just say how you chose Zoë, or, you know, why traditional music singer?
Well, I think deep down everyone knows that all the good music comes from traditional music. I mean, later sometimes composers turn into classical music, but the roots of our music are the music just comes out of the ground and no one knows who wrote it, it's just there, these tunes are just there. Yeah. I've always been very attracted to it. So I try and build on that in my music as well. So I'm very happy to go back to tradition. And Zoë to me says it's really just a voice that I wanted for this traditional feeling. So I think we shouldn't divide music into traditional and non-traditional, but music comes from there and it's very nice to keep our roots.
I absolutely agree. These kinds of collaborations are very exciting. And Zoë, you're a composer as well.
Yes.
So presumably when you take somebody else's work, and he's living, he's here with us today, you know, do you find yourself wandering into the compositional mode saying, oh, I wonder why you came up with this, or?
Well, I think it's just, it's very exciting to work on new music. And of course, it's an honor that Garth is performing it as well. But even the whole notion that music is living and breathing and developing and people are creating it, and as we work on songs together, we're developing it as well, saying, oh, maybe we should actually repeat that little section and take more time here, and you're shaping the music. And that's very exciting. And to think that nobody has heard it before, nobody has played it before, So it's an honour.
Perfect segue to letting us hear it. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So we're back to the pocket concerto, parts 2 and 3, and the second part, as I said, is a slow movement. And I was inspired by a poem by Seamus Heaney called The Given Note, which some of you may know, which speaks about a tune which came off the wind off the sea, which is very linked to the wind, so it's all about wind today and Irish songs. And I didn't take the actual song he mentioned, but I like this idea of a sort of misty sea scene, and this gradually this music forming. It's music from the fairies, is the name of the tune that came out of it. So in the middle, you can hear the fairies dancing on the water as the clouds part at one moment, we see the fairies dancing, but otherwise it's all very cloudy and mysterious. And after that, will be the last movement, which is called Irish Variations, we mentioned, with featuring Sinéad's cadenza near the end. But these are actually variations on a composite tune I made out of 3 tunes. And I have to say, I noticed looking around today, he's gone, Cuivín O'Reilly, who is sitting in that very seat, whose child is making the noise there, is very responsible for this movement as well, because he taught me 2 of the tunes which are in it. And I sort of stuck them together. So he's not going to hear it, but I'll tell him all about it afterwards. I'm very grateful. Thank you, Cuivín. So first of all, the song from the sea, and then the Irish variation.
Thank you.
This encore for you, but actually we need one more viola player for this. Is that Martin Moriarty? did you bring your viola, Martin? I've changed to a slightly different instrument, a very different instrument. This is a kind of viola, but it's called a viola d'amore, which is a viola which has more love than a normal viola, and many more strings. You've got seven strings that I play, and another seven strings which are just resonance strings, so they sing along in the background, like the girls at the back of the stage. And the very nice thing of the viola d'amore is when you stop playing it, it sounds great. So at the beginning of the piece, I'll leave lots of little silences. You can hear the aftermath of a viola d'amore sound. nicest part. It's called Pasaka in this case.
Thank you. you.